Hi, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden this time of year. We're here in like mid-November now, and look at my kale bed is doing amazing. It's totally filled in. These guys are basically touching, so when they're touching, that means I need to go around and harvest, and probably pretty soon I'm going to harvest all the curly leaf kale, including the green and the purple kind that I got grown, burgundy, and we're going to make some kale chips out of it. Over this side, you guys can see my little baby lettuces, all red lettuces, three different kinds, new red fire, red sails, and like salad red or something, like oak leaf style. Doing really nice, growing in real nice because of my garden practices, right? Not gonna talk about my garden this episode. What we're gonna talk about is even more important, and it's the five most important organic gardening tips or information that you've never heard before in one place at one time. You know, I've taken all these pieces of knowledge that I've learned from all over, from many different people, and also what I know about health, because I got into eating healthfully a long time before I even started gardening, right? And I'm combining these together. And nobody before that I know have ever combined all these different elements so that you guys could have a better garden and, more importantly, have a better life and better health if you eat the foods you guys are growing. And to remind you guys, that is the number one reason why I'm growing my own food, to have the highest quality food, because you are what you eat. If you eat junk food, you're gonna be a junk food person and you're probably not gonna think straight. I mean, there are leaders in power that eat, that they love junk food. And maybe that's why some of the things are going on. I have no idea. But what I do know about is gardening and health, so let's get right into this. All right, so the first thing I wanna say is that this is not gonna be specific any garden advice, like don't use this product or this product. This is gonna be my overall philosophy, and a philosophy that I think you guys should also adopt and follow. There are many different camps in gardening, you know. You could use a mitt lighter method, you could use a raised bed garden, you could use organic fertilizer from the big box store, you could use a food soil web, you could put on rock dust. And you know, I've tried to incorporate the best of the best into my own gardening style. And that's what I teach you guys. These are things that you're not gonna hear on any other organic gardening channel. You know, just because I've come up with them and combined all these things. What you will learn in this episode is how, you know, you can improve your garden and your health through these five tips and five critical areas that I want you guys to focus on if you guys wanna be an exceptional organic gardener. Most people do not take these in consideration when gardening. They think I could just plant some plants and throw some organic chicken manure fertilizer down, which is probably my factory farm, and I'm gonna be all right. And yes, while that can grow, and I've visited people, Timo, whatever, in Houston, Texas, where he basically doesn't do anything, he is doing some of these things unknowingly to him. So the more of these you guys can incorporate into your gardening style, your gardening practice, your garden overall philosophy, that's gonna guide you to be more successful. You will be more successful in gardening, but more importantly, in having better health. That's why I got into gardening, because I had failing health. When I was younger, I almost lost my life. I was hospitalized. The doctor said I might not make it out alive and I needed to turn my health around. I did that through major dietary changes. I'm not gonna get into that in this episode, but what I will say is that part of my dietary changes are to have the highest quality food that has the most nutrition in it, which is what you'll be learning about in just a second. So there are five different elements that I'll be going over, not like elements as in like periodic table of the elements, but these are elements that I want you guys to incorporate in your garden style. Number one is the most important, it's the water. If it wasn't for water, my garden would not grow. Now there are other important elements too, and what I'm gonna do in each of these elements, I'm gonna go over, number one, what is the element? Number two, why it's important to our health. Number three, why it's important to the plant health. And number four, how to improve that specifically in the plant health, because that's what I'm concerned about. I'm eating my plants, and actually I'm just set up to juice right after I make this video, so I'll be literally juicing some of my plants to get out their juice and get it into me, which includes the water, and that's why water is super critical for your plant's health. So the first thing I want to say is that water from your plants is the best water on earth, right? It is filtered by the plant, by the microbial system and the bacteria and microbes in the soil that then basically allow your plant to uptake it. The plant will then structure it or order the water, maybe called easy water, and it's better at hydration and working and doing what it needs to do in the little plant bodies there. So don't buy bottled water, juice your plants, and I do sell juicers for a living. Why is water important in human health? Because every function in our body depends on hydration, on water, on fluids to move things in and out of cells. There's osmotic pressure and there's a potassium sodium pumps that move things in and out of the cells. You know, our blood is all liquid based around water. It's critical that we stay properly hydrated and even have the best kind of water to do the hydration. And the water from the plants is the water to do just that. There's a book that came out many years ago called The Body's Many Cries for Water, which talked about just by being dehydrated could cause many health illnesses. And in my life, I would consider myself a biohacker. I want to optimize what I'm doing in my life. And, you know, simply I found that the plant water that I get to extract into juices is one of the best to consume. Now, yes, of course, if you eat the plants, you'll also get the water, but I'm really able to super concentrate the water that I'm getting from the plants by juicing it. Why is water important to the plants? Well, the water basically transports nutrients up into the plant. It allows the plants to grow. Have you ever heard of this stuff called water wetter? If you guys grew up, you know, a long time ago, they had this stuff, water wetter. You'd actually take this bottle of stuff, you'd pour it in your radiator, in your car, and then your radiator temperature would just drop like 5-10 degrees. I forget what it was when I did it at the time. Because it basically made the water more conductive or made it wetter. And that's what the plants do to the water. They take the water, they filter the water, and they turn it into a structure. In the case of many green leafy vegetables, it also could make it low deuterium, which you'll have to look up on its own, because that's a whole different subject that I'm not going to get into today, that makes it more efficient to do the task at hand so that it does not impede the cellular growth of the leaves in the plant. As you guys know, if your plants are wilty, you see them not happy, you know, they can't absorb nutrients. Sometimes if you have tomatoes and they have like that stuff on the bottom, you know, the end rot, right? People say, oh, it's a calcium deficiency. Well, yes, it could be a calcium deficiency, or maybe you're not watering enough so that the plant cannot transport the water in the plant. So literally you could turn around and make sick plants healthy by giving them some water. So how can you give your plants better water? So number one is a practice I do is filter the water. Very important. You want to take out all the impurities, especially the things like chlorine and all the different chemicals that are in the water supply these days, drugs and who knows what else, right? So have a water filter that'll make the job of the soil and the plant a lot easier. Furthermore, if you want to take it to the next level, which on some levels I do because I'm incoming to the water in my house and in my backyard, it gets all the basically more structured water using magnets or vortexers. You know, in nature, they have flowforms or rivers that also will do something to structure the water. You know, a simple way to do structured water is to freeze the water and then melt it and then feed your plants melt water, which was kind of fun when I go to Costco, because inside the Costco warehouse, they'll have like fruit trees. Actually, I think they had some a couple months ago. And they'll just take ice from like the deli or whatever, and they're just basically put ice onto the plants and then let the ice melt to water the plants slowly so that they don't get runoff all over their warehouse. But also, unbeknowingly to them, that's also a better water for the plants because it's actually now structured instead of going through all these pipes and all this stuff. Other ways you guys can improve water is through aeration, and also the best water on earth comes pre-structured from the sky, which I don't get a lot here because I live in one of the driest, largest cities in the U.S. Where it doesn't rain a lot, which actually I like a lot because I'm not a big fan of the rain, getting wet, and not being able to go out and garden because you're all wet. The rain, one of the best sources of water. So collect your guys' rainwater and use that to water your garden, or better yet, hopefully you move somewhere where it rains a lot, like in Hawaii, where it just rains all the time and your plants are going to have the best source of water as it is. Second element that literally is an element that I want you guys to include in your philosophy of organic gardening are trace minerals, right? It is commonly known that standard agriculture focuses around three primary minerals, NPK, right? Nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus. And it's these three numbers you see on every commercial fertilizer bag, and that's what's needed to grow the food! Or so people think that grow the food with NPK, because seriously, a chemical, you know, made factory fertilizer, 15, 15, 15, or triple 30, could surely grow plants. But in my opinion, and based on research I've seen, it will be lacking, right? You will be lacking things, and the plants will not operate properly because the trace minerals are critical. Now, I'm not talking about the other 12 to maybe 16 trace minerals that standard agriculture may say and, you know, say are important in a much lesser degree than the three main minerals, but I'm talking about 70 to 90 different trace minerals that exist here on the planet, right? If we go to like rocks that are formed, which are basically minerals, and we grind them up, we could have trace minerals, right? Those rocks, over many years of geologic action, get ground up, they go into glacial meltwater, and then they basically run off into the ocean. So the ocean, another very important source of trace minerals. Now, yes, it is totally true that most every soil around the world will have different levels of trace minerals, but my goal is to have a whole wide spectrum of trace minerals in my garden. It's like, you know, if you have friends from out of town, you only take them to McDonald's, which I don't recommend eating McDonald's, and if they don't like hamburgers and fast food, they're screwed. Like, don't ever take me to McDonald's because I ain't going to eat it. And if you take me to like a, you know, in Las Vegas, they have those big buffets with all different kinds of food, right? You could select, and if you have guests, you take them there, they're probably going to find something they want to eat. I think I could find something I'd want to eat there, right? But, you know, likewise, your garden, there's so many different trace minerals that some microbes may favor than others, and some fungi and different bacteria in your plants will want some of those. You know, some plants are trace mineral accumulators, such as catnip or Brazil nuts are selenium accumulators. And I'm sure that those minerals are required for that plant or that tree to grow properly. So trace minerals have existed on the planet since the planet was born. I mean, our planet is literally made of minerals. So why wouldn't we want to put the whole spectrum of minerals into the soil? So now I want to talk about trace minerals and human health, which is probably another reason why I had trace minerals in my garden, so that I could get the trace minerals from my plants instead of eat trace mineral powders. Because the other thing that is often not said is that when you buy a supplement, it's not in the right form with the right charge, so our body can't absorb it. When we put the trace minerals in the ground and it runs through the plant, runs through the microbial action, basically in the plant, it's in a more a better state that we can absorb the minerals from the foods we eat, which is how we're supposed to work. We're not big rock eaters where we could digest rocks, literally. While we can eat minerals like salt and you'll absorb some of it, it's not as efficient as getting your trace minerals from the vegetables. Now, they have correlated things like a deficiency of chromium and vanadium with people that have diabetes. Not to say that you have diabetes because of the chromium and vanadium deficiency. There's probably many other reasons, but generally they sell chromium, vanadium supplements for people that have diabetes, and maybe your blood sugar ranking will improve. Of course, my solution, if I had diabetes, which I don't, would be to eat natural foods. You know, all this processed foods, junk food, animal foods in excess can wreak havoc on your body when you're not eating enough plants, which are what we are optimally designed to eat, in my personal opinion. Now, another reason why trace minerals are quite critical and quite important is because of your immune system. If you don't have proper trace minerals in your body, which we, once again, should be getting from our foods, but industrial foods do not add trace minerals in any large or appreciable quantities into the growing soil, because they find it's not profitable, but there are some companies that are doing it and they find it even increase their yields, so they got healthier plants by adding something like a rock dust to it. But why trace minerals can be important for immune system and many other different systems in your body, because minerals act like building blocks, right? Along with minerals and something I'll be talking about next, enzymes, you know, it can catalyze reactions and different things happening in your body. For example, Keishan's disease happened in China. And Keishan's disease occurred when there was a virus, the Coxsackie virus, coupled with a selenium deficiency And then people in those regions that didn't have selenium in the soil existing naturally would get the Coxsackie virus. It would become apparent, and then basically it could end your life, because it was like a heart issue or heart disease, basically, because you're selenium deficient and you got the virus. Now, of course, if you didn't get the virus and you still had a selenium deficiency, you wouldn't be messed up. But, you know, so that shows the importance, and especially with the COVID around, I want to make sure I got all my minerals, because I don't know exactly how they work and I don't really care. But I know that if I have the right minerals that are on the planet in the right ratios that the food would provide me, if it's in the soil, then I feel confident that that is one of the methods that I could lead the best health ever. Plants, they also require minerals. So why do we add NPK and maybe up to 12 to 16 different minerals? Because they see a response. Like, you add nitrogen to the plant, it grows faster, it turns more green, right? And they've shown, you know, in the case of like up to 16 different minerals, that the plants do respond. Well, what about all the responses that we have not seen, we cannot, you know from science, that are small things that we don't exactly understand yet? Life is complex. While we think we're, you know, super smart, we know a fraction of the soil microbiome. We know a fraction of what we could know. So I say, why wait until they figure this stuff out? I'm just going to supplement my soils with the trace minerals to give my plants the nutrients they need. So, for example, the backbone of all these plants so that they could stand up erect, right? And, you know, like, we have calcium in our bones, they have silica as a primary strengthening agent to make their stems and their leaves straight up. I mean, if they didn't have silica, it would just probably just flop over and it wouldn't be strong. Boron, essential for your plants because it causes cross-linking, which basically makes super strong fibers so the plants could be more resilient, right? And it's all these different trace minerals that we don't completely understand, that, you know, standard agriculture will just poo-poo out and say, they're not important. We haven't learned anything about that yet. Well, I personally feel, and many other people into organic agriculture feels, that they are important. And that's why rock dust, when people do apply it and do apply things like ocean solids or ocean minerals, they see a response in their plants. Their plants wake up, their plants are happy, their plants are more disease and stress free. And I mean, even like when your plants have the right trace minerals, right, they're gonna have a stronger immune system. They're gonna be able to fight off bugs, pests, and disease more effectively, because once again, maybe the Coxsackie virus is gonna affect your plants, probably doesn't. But if they don't have their selenium, then they won't be able to fight off the Coxsackie virus or whatever other bacteria or virus that they may get. And every different trace mineral may play a role in this. I mean, another thing is, like, I take like powder, these powders that have some of the rare earth elements, trace minerals, such as platinum and ruthenium. And, you know, it's like, I believe these in small quantities also important to us. And of course, would the plant really uptake these minerals? Because my platinum-based supplement is grown from lettuce. They basically add platinum to the soil, the plant takes it up, and then this lettuce has out of the sky high platinum in it. I had a video previously which you could search for. It's like game-changing, health-improving fertilizer that I made with Robert Rissingham. And, you know, it's his platinum product that I take, and he's a big fan of the trace minerals, and he has specific fertilizers that he'll sell you that you could add to your soil if you have diabetes, because these are the minerals that are missing, that they've correlated with people deficient in diabetes are missing these minerals, and that's why he puts that in the fertilizer. He has a fertilizer, you know, to help people with fertility issues, which I did take, and I didn't get anybody pregnant that I'm aware of it yet. And I'm not trying either, so, you know. He has one for your heart. He has one for different topics, because there are correlations between trace mineral deficiencies and human health, but I believe strongly that also with plant health as well. Now, let me say this also, too many minerals or the improper balance of minerals can be quite bad and quite toxic to you and your plants. I mean, heavy metals, you know, mercury, lead, these things, if you have, you know, live in New York City and they painted lead paint 100 years ago and it flaked off in your soil and you're growing in that, right? That's an unnatural source of lead toxicity in your soil that now your plants, they will take up. But in nature, for the most part, I'm sure there's exceptions because I know you guys are going to find one. You know, in general, in nature, the system is self-balancing, and in nature's proportions, you know, the lead and the mercury and all these things are in really small amounts and not going to be problematic in my personal opinion. Of course, consult a doctor if you feel that important, you know, about this. But I also have a link that I remember put link down below. You know, heavy metals and rock dust. You know, is it going to kill you? I made a video about that because people were concerned. John, you're promoting rock dust and has heavy metals. Well, heavy metals are only an issue when they get concentrated. And once again, man concentrated them for its benefit, you know, like leaded gas when I was growing up as a kid, right? And that was maybe good for the cars, but bad for the environment and bad because it bioaccumulated lead. So once again, you know, if you have the proper minerals, it can also boost the health of your plant and its root growth. Very important. And then finally, final comment on minerals. How do you get minerals in your garden soil? Well, don't just go buy the compost at the big box store. While that will have some minerals, it's not a good balance of minerals because what's in the compost are the minerals that are in the plants or the items that are the compost are made out of. And, you know, in many cases, like food waste and yard clippings are just using NPK fertilizer from a box, and it still does not have the range of trace minerals that are out there. So I strongly encourage you guys, because I am a big fan since I've been gardening, since I started, of rock dust, which are basically ground up rocks, generally basalt or you know, some kind of volcanic rock ground up into a fine powder that then will enhance and add up to 70 different trace minerals in your soil in nature's balance. Super critical. The next source of the trace minerals you guys can seek out are ocean solids. So I've used a product called C90. I've used a product called Ocean Grown Ocean Solution. I think I have a few others, but those are the two ones that I primarily use. And just literally, you know, a little bit of that with a whole gallon of water. Actually, I sprayed both these beds on either side of me with the Ocean Grown Ocean Solution. You know, it was like just a cap full to like 1 gallon of water, and took a backpack spray and just foiler fed the everything all over. And I mean, look at these guys now. They're looking totally amazing. Plants will respond. You can foiler feed the liquid minerals, but the rock dust should be incorporated in your soil after every growing season. I top off my beds with about that much of a mixture of compost and rock dust and worm castings and whatever else I have laying around, and I have videos on that also if you guys are interested. Of course, other products besides the ocean solids and the rock dust, things that grow in the ocean, because all the minerals on the land are being washed off into the oceans. So things like seaweed, I personally eat seaweeds in my life to get my iodine, or iodine if you want to pronounce it like that. But it plants grown in the sea, such as sea vegetables, such as algae, and even phytoplankton, can add to the trace mineral content of your soil, of your plants, and also more importantly, they include many other different benefits that I'm not going to cover in this episode as well. Third element is the microbiome. So in this specific instance, my microbiome is a community of organisms, fungi, archaea, bacteria that inhabit an organism or environment. You may have heard about the human microbiome, right? But there's also a soil microbiome, the microbiome in the ecology of the whole planet, you know, of different areas of geologic regions, right? There's a symbiotic relationship between us and all and our microbiome. Now, why is microbiome important for human health? Well, there's been a lot of research lately. When I got into health foods and eating healthfully, there was not a lot known about microbiome, but now there is today. It is shown that microbiome is super critical for our health. To have a healthy microbiome, it bolsters your immune system. As a matter of fact, it is, you know, it plays a dominant role in our immune system from what I understand. Our microbiome helps us digest our food and make secondary metabolites, like special fatty acids that are critical for our health and provide us literally with energy. Super critical. You know, the microbiome live on our skin and can protect us from things like infections and bad bacteria. I mean, they live in symbiosis with us. They are so important that actually they've discovered that we are actually more microbiome or bacteria than human. So think about that one. So why is the microbiome so important to your plants? Well, I want you guys to read a book for the full download on it called Teeming with Microbes, but it's all about this food soil web. but the microbes are critical to your garden. I can only summarize it in a few short sentences here, but basically the microbes make it possible to digest the organic matter and the trace minerals and allow your plants to uptake that. The better the microbiome of the soil, the more disease and pest resistant your plant will have. Plus, the faster they're going to grow, the faster they're going to put on, you know, root growth, the faster they're going to produce for you. The more phytonutrients and phytochemicals, which we'll be talking about in a second, they're going to be producing so that you could get them if you guys are eating them. You know, the plants will be more resilient to different stressors in the world, whether you forget to water them a day or two, or whether it's super hot or super cold, right? The better the microbiome, the more your system is going to be stable instead of fluctuating all over the place. You know, that's why also, you know, when we eat the foods with beneficial microbes on it, they go into us and then we could eat that. Plus, when we eat the plant foods, right, no animal foods could do this for you. The plant foods feed our personal microbiome because they provide the exact food the microbes need, which is the fiber, the soluble fiber that our microbiome loves. And in animal products, there is zero fiber, unless you're maybe eating the guts of an animal that ate plants, but then you're still eating the fiber secondhand. Now, another reason why the microbiome is so important for your plants is because basically, here it is, the good microbes could basically compete out the bad microbes. So if you basically, you know, do foliar sprays of beneficial microbes, which should come in many different ways, you know, that's gonna basically gonna take the place and fill in with the healthy microbiome, and basically things like pythium and root rot and things like downy mold and mildew are gonna land on your leaves and it's gonna get eaten up by the bacteria because that's their job, to eat and dispose and decompose. I just made that up, but it's true. And so they're gonna basically kick butt and be on your side as your working team to keep your garden healthy. So how can you have a better microbiome for your plants and then you when you eat your plants? Well, there's a few ways to do this. Number one, of course, is organic matter. Composted organic matter will have microbes in it because it's the organic matter that is digested by the microbes, like the bacteria, that make the compost happen. Now, I don't just recommend buying compost that's made, you know, in a bag or made in a fast turn system, because it's gonna have different kinds of microbes than one that's like slow made. So my compost is a bit more slow made versus stuff, you know, in a commercial food recycling or yard waste recycling system where they're just trying to get inputs in, compost it, and then sell it to you and get it out as fast as possible so they can make as much money as they can. You know, I think they're definitely missing the ball. So I incorporate several different kinds of composts into my soil to have some of these pre-built microbiome elements, including the bacteria, some of the fungi, and even archaea into my soil. Now, of course, another thing you guys can do is incorporate things like compost tea made out of worm castings and insect frasses that could also incorporate microbiome. Use other different kinds of compost, such as the fungal dominated compost, which I have a few good episodes on, basically is rich in fungi action. Make your own leaf mold compost, super critical. Now, aside from all those, you can make IMOs if you want, but I also like to include other different bacterial sprays, EM1, I used some other microbial product the other day, I forget the product, but I sprayed it all over my garden. You know, there's many different inoculants that you could use. I put on mycorrhizae. These are some excellent ways to give your garden a good microbiome, but make sure if you guys are going to use some of these bacteria in your garden and microbiome elements, make sure you have a good place to live once you spray them out so that they're going to hang out. So how you could do that? Provide them a good place to live, right? Have roots living in the ground year round in your garden. I know sometimes a year you guys aren't growing. Maybe some of you guys right now it's snowing where you are. I don't know. But you always at least plant a cover crop so something's growing, because literally the microbes live on the roots in the soil. Very critical. And if they don't have a place to live, they might go dormant, then they could come back next year, or they might just go away. Another thing is protect your soil. Cover your soil up, right? Give them a nice cushion. If you go out on a nice cold winter's day, you're not going to go out naked unless you're totally crazy or one of those people that live in Norway and then just go for those ice cold plunges, right? You're going to wear like a big jacket so it insulates you from the external weather so you could handle being outside. You know, if you're a crossing guard, if you're a security officer or policeman, right? You got to be outside, or construction worker all day. You're going to wear some insulation. So insulate your guys' soil from the high heat, from the cold weather, and also to keep a nice, basically, conditions, including the right moisture level for your microbes. It could also help aerate your soil, and you can use microbes instead of tilling, which I also have an episode on. Next element I wanted to share with you guys today are enzymes. Enzymes are critical for our health and for the plant's health as well. This is something that's not normally talked about, but I'm going to include it because it is so important. You know, without enzyme reactions, things would not happen, right? All my plants here have active enzymes within them working to make their life possible, right? If you go to the store and try to buy food in a package, right? All the enzymes are wiped out because enzymes cause food spoilage, among other things. And so all the food you buy at the store is processed, kill all the enzymes because that could cause the food to go bad, and they want to have a long shelf life so that they could make their profits. Meanwhile, you know, the plants have tons of enzymes. So I love to eat my plants to get some enzymes. I even take additional enzymes because what are enzymes? Enzymes are basically proteins, specialized proteins that catalyze reactions in our body or in the plant. And you know, if it wasn't for enzymes, we would literally not be alive. Enzymes can be affected, you know, by heat, for example, and maybe too cold. You could denature enzymes, so they're not going to be active, so things aren't going to work as quick. And that's why having a garden, you know, in certain temperature ranges is the best. And if it's too cold, not good for gardening generally, or too hot. So you want to kind of get in the Goldilocks zone. for temperatures for garden to maximize enzyme production. It is said that enzymes lose their life or start denaturing at 118 degrees, but of course that depends on the specific enzyme. Now, enzymes are critical for our human health. They do many things. You know, there are digestive enzymes that help us break down and digest the food that we eat, right? Some people may not have a lactase enzyme. You know, if you're Asian and you could drink milk and then you're having bloating, gas, and belching and all these crazy things because you can't digest milk, so then you could take a lactose enzyme to digest the lactase. And, you know, my thing is, hey, if we don't have the enzyme to digest milk, should we even be drinking milk in the first place? But that's a different topic for a different video. Anyways, enzymes help us digest our food. You can't take supplemental enzymes if you're eating a lot of cooked foods that don't have any enzymes, because once again, if you heat food up, it kills all the enzymes. Your body may not be able to digest it as well, right? Furthermore, you know, we have systemic enzymes in us also that help clean our blood, that help work as anti-inflammatories, help many different processes in our bodies. Literally, enzymes are life. They are so critical to us, but not often talked about in gardening. Enzymes can also modulate our immune system, especially in these times of COVID, I think are particularly important. So, you know, I take 3 enzyme pills every night, aside from eating all the live food, fruits and vegetables that have active enzymes in it. Of course, some foods like, you know, figs, they have ficin, and that's what makes your tongue burn. It literally breaks down the protein in your tongue if you have unripe figs, right? They have, you know, papain, from papaya, and bromelain from pineapples, right? And how do the plants use these, right? The plants use these because proteins, everything's made of protein. And if, for example, if a bug goes to eat the pineapple before it's ripe and the enzyme levels decrease, right? Those enzymes will literally melt the bug because the bug's made out of protein. Figs have ficin. Ficin is a very powerful protein digester, and that'll literally melt the bugs because of the enzymes that the plants create. Why are enzymes important in plants, right? Enzymes in plants have many different functions, and I'm not the super botanist to know all this, but what I will say is that they help basically catalyze reactions, make your plants stronger, help them absorb nutrients, and even provide them defense from pests. It's quite amazing, right? So here's the thing. This whole bed right here is all kale. All these kale plants have these things called glucosinolates that the plant makes, right? In addition to the glucosinolates, the plants have also enzymes that are basically locked into the cell walls and not released until you break or you tear a leaf. I just tore this leaf. Guess what? There's an instant enzyme reaction that's occurring in here. Isothiocyanates are being created because I just damaged the leaf, and the glucosinolates that are existing in there, Now, the isothiocyanates are being released because of the enzymes that are now breaking that down. And then basically, it causes this food to taste more peppery to us. But why does the plant do this? Does the plant do this because isothiocyanates are anti-cancer for us to eat, which is really good. And that's why you can probably eat some brassica family of plants every day. And I rotate all the different greens that I eat, eating some brassicas almost most days these days because I have a whole garden full. So they're very powerful. But the plant makes it not for our benefit, but for its benefit, because basically isothiocyanates can deter pests from eating it, you know, and be super helpful. I mean, for example, and another thing is, you know, this is ultimate anti-nematode recipe right here, right? So the plants make this and exert it into the root zone and can be used to control nematodes and bad bacteria and fungi in the soil. So how could we use this as gardeners to benefit us? Well, if you have extra greens or at the end of the season, right, or if you just grow mustard greens in a field, for example, you could take those and then crush them all up, because if you just bury these leaves whole, they're not going to have the reaction. Or if you cook them first, they're not going to have that enzymatic reaction to create the anti-cancer compounds. That's why, like, I use all my brassica greens raw, unheated, so that I could have these anti-cancer properties. I could blend the brassica plants, including their roots and their greens and their stems, with some water, and then I will create my own fumigate to fumigate the soil using plants, the power of plants, which the plants have created naturally. Without these enzyme systems, you know, the plants would not be able to produce these different anti-nutrients that could repel the pests, right? Enzymes are super critical for our health and our plants' health. So how can you increase the enzymes that are available to your plants? Well, very simply, right, while we can create our own enzymes, plants can create their own enzymes. If they're optimally healthy, they will create more enzymes. And here's the thing, if you add bacteria and fungi and archaea, they could also create enzymes. For example, chitinase. Chitinase is an enzyme that is basically produced by the worms, or multiplied by the worms, probably more specifically. When they eat chitin, they make chitinase in their guts, and then they poop it out in their worm castings, and then we feed that chitin A's to our plants could uptake that and then be more resilient to different, you know, bugs that have exoskeletons that are degraded or dissolved by the chitin. All these things I've pieced together all over time, and that's why having a wide variety of inputs in your garden are quite important, because you never know how one will affect another unless you've done the research or traveled around like I have, or made over 1500 videos and interviewed so many different people, or going to different conferences and lectures and health events, you know, to learn all these different pieces that I'm putting together for you guys in just one video. So the fifth element that I want to share with you guys today before I sign off, I gotta make my juice, was actually a good movie that I watched back in the day, The Fifth Element, but actually it is phytochemicals. So plants produce phytochemicals. They're literally basically chemicals made by the plants. Every plant you guys see here is its own chemical factory. It doesn't need a big building. It has all the resources it needs, including all the different soil microbes and all the minerals and the sun, the water, oxygen, everything it needs, carbon dioxide, to basically make its own chemicals, phytochemicals, right? And once again, these play many roles for us and for the plants, you know. The phytochemicals could also be classified as phytonutrients if they are actually good for us, or it could actually be called phytotoxins, which could be toxic to us, you know, if we ingest those, like oleander. Don't want to ingest oleander, creates phytotoxins. But on the other hand, my purple kale over here, on the other hand, creates anthocyanins, which are the purple pigments that are actually quite healthy for us. So phytonutrients are one of the main reasons why I grow my own food. Every different plant will make different kinds of phytonutrients and phytochemicals. We could select those for certain properties. You know, it is shown that this plant is good for diabetes, or this plant is good for this. Not going to get into that whole playing that game. But what I will say is that I'm growing the plants for their phytonutrients. As I mentioned before, all the plants in this bed, which is over 100 plants, are all powerful anti-cancer fighters because of their phytochemicals. The other thing is, this whole bed also very powerful anti-aging for us. When you eat your greens, that's what my channel is called, Growing Your Greens. They are the critical component of food that, unfortunately, less than 10% of Americans eat their servings of recommended servings of vegetables a day, which is a dismal. So I want you guys to really ramp it up. My goal every day is to eat 2 pounds of greens. And this time of year, with all the greens in my garden, the lettuce coming on board, I'm still planting stuff on the other side. Easy to do. I might juice a pound of greens, which is like 1 cup of juice, which is nothing. Got 1 cup or 1 pound into me. And then I might eat a pound of greens in my salad tonight. I think I'm going to eat some arugula greens, which also have nitric oxide enhancing benefits in the body. So phytonutrients can protect us from stress and disease and are critical. And most people eat a phytonutrient deficient diet because it's actually not accounted for on nutrition labels, right? Carbs, fat, and protein, the macronutrients, are accounted for, but these valuable phytonutrients are not. So I encourage you guys to, number one, grow your own food, eat as many plant foods as you can, and animal foods do not contain any large amounts of these plant chemicals unless the animal got it secondhand through the plant. I like to just get it from the plant and concentrate this in juicing, which is one of the reasons why I love juicing so much, so I could get more of these beneficial plant compounds into me. So how can phytochemicals help your plants, and why do you want your plants to be the best phytochemical factories that they can be? Make America great again. Make your plants better phytonutrient creators, right? Why is it important? Well, the phytochemicals basically help the plant also resist disease and pathogens and viruses and molds and mildews and bacteria and fungi infections. It could also help prevent, you know, pests from eating them. So these are good things to have because your plants create them for its benefit, not ours. But of course, a lot of phytochemicals that plants make, create, can be beneficial for us as well. Oh, and the other thing I forgot to mention is that the phytochemicals can also help them attract pollinators or do the tasks they want to do. I mean, phytochemicals are the colors of food, among other things, and it can make foods look more appealing, make fruits look super brilliant and ripe so that you eat the fruit and you eat the seeds and you poop the seeds out, and then the seeds will grow into new plants. I mean, it could attract, you know, birds and the bees, you know, the smells or phytochemicals, you know, to attract different pollinators so that they could get pollinated so that the plant could do what it needs to do in life. And I'm all for letting the plants be as promiscuous as possible in my garden because they're probably getting more action than I am. So the wider spectrum of nutrition you can give your plants, including the things we talked about earlier, will allow them to create more efficiently more phytochemicals so that they could be stronger and healthier. For example, in my opinion, and based on some research I've seen, feeding simply NPK fertilizer makes your plants weak because they will not produce as much phytochemicals, you know, as something grown in like organic gardening with rock dust and good soil microbiome that has a more wide spectrum because they have more building blocks. You know, say you have only bricks, rocks, and mortar to build a house, or you had bricks, rocks, mortar, steel, and wood. Which one could you build a better house with? If you had more building blocks, you could make a better house, right? And that's how it is. If you're just limited feeding NPK and focusing on NPK, right, your plants are not going to make as much phytochemicals. And then guess what? What happens when your plants can't make phytochemicals to defend itself from pests, bugs, and disease and fungus? Well, then you got to spray conventional, you know, pesticides. You got to spray fungicides. You got to spray pesticides. You got to spray all this stuff because now you're trying to play, I don't want to say God, but you're trying to play God to give the plants what it needs because that's what we're told through agriculture, through, you know, bigger corporations that be. They're selling these commercial products that just using the natural methods of growing that has been existing on Earth for millions of years, right? I try to duplicate the best way to grow the food, and that's why I add a lot of nutrients to my crops so that I can have more levels of phytonutrients, which are good for the plants so they can be more resistant to bugs, disease, and pests, create greater levels of protein within them that aren't chomped off by the bugs. But then more importantly for me, I get to eat these plants that have greater levels of protein and more phytonutrients so that I could be healthy as well. So how can you provide your plants better phytochemicals? Well, you can, because a plant is going to decide on the phytochemicals it creates. But here are a few tips. Number one, you want to have all the different necessary prerequisites, like when you went to college, prerequisites, you know, to have a healthy soil microbiome, good organic matter, good fungi matter, good bacterial, good mycorrhizae, right? You want to have all the different components in there, as well as the trace minerals, the rock dust, you know. You don't want to add things in too large of quantities because that could imbalance your soil. Nature, I like to think, is a self-balancing system unless we get involved too much. And that's why all the inputs I use in my garden are basically nature's quantities and not these artificially inflated 30, 30, 30 or 15, 15, 15 bag fertilizers that could offset your garden, your grow, right? And so using nature's inputs and the way nature grows will always provide you a better result. I mean, is nature wrong? You know, do we think we're smarter than nature by using these chemicals and these things made in a factory that corporations and companies profit off of, right? I don't think so. In addition, aside from providing the best environment for your plants to grow and all the nutrients and everything, a good food soil web, you also want to stress your plants out sometimes, whether that's intentionally or unintentionally. Say we have a cold snap tonight, which we're not probably going to get a cold snap, and it's not going to freeze probably for a couple more weeks. So I still got a couple more weeks of harvesting my peppers and tomatoes on the other side of the garden. But say we get a cold snap, right? That isn't a stress for my plants. And when the plants come about stress, right, it's like for them, it's like working muscles. How do you build muscles? Do you build muscles by like sitting on your computer all day and typing and watching YouTube videos like many of you guys are? No! You gotta go to the gym and lift weights! I mean, I don't go to the gym and lift weights, but I lift 5 gallon buckets of water and I'm like running on my outdoor kitchen sink as I'm washing my, scrubbing my vegetables and my kitchen equipment outside. And then I basically have to take those buckets of water and carry around and just dump them in my pots and dump them in my trees and dump them in stuff. And I'm working my muscles, you know? Real muscles, right? And, you know, your plants likewise, right? When the wind comes, it blows the wind. We have 60 mile an hour winds today, right? These plants are being whipped back and forth, right? What's happening? The plants being, oh my God, I'm getting worked out. I'm getting shoved. I'm getting pushed. I need to build a stronger backbone so I can be stronger so that when the winds come next time, I'm not going to, you know, keel over. So yeah, stress out your plants and maybe don't water them as much as you might want to. Maybe overwatering them a little bit and get them used. Like I visited the pineapple farm in Hawaii where it rains a little bit too much for pineapples and they overwater their plants just a little bit, not too much because you still want to be in that Goldilocks zone, but maybe on the high end of the Goldilocks zone to get your plants used to a little bit more water or a little bit less water and switch it off. Maybe you live in a climate like I do where my weather stresses my plants out so that they have higher levels of phytonutrients, which in some cases, unless it's like the wintertime, things aren't that sweet, but they're a lot more nutritious in my personal opinion because of the phytochemicals that the plants, literally my kale, like I don't really grow kale in the summertime because the kale is spicy hot, like it is hot. It's a plant phytochemicals that are protecting the plants from the heat that make it almost intolerable to eat, but I eat some because I know they're good for me, but they're not the tastiest, right? So yeah, plants are amazing, nature's amazing. I want you guys to follow nature, follow my lead, follow these five elements that I've shared with you guys today so that you guys could have the best garden ever. You know, I covered most of these or all these topics in previous episodes, over 1500 episodes I have on at present time. I'm not gonna necessarily link any direct videos, but if you search my channel for different topics, you know, you'll learn about some of the methods I use to have the healthiest garden and model nature the best I can so that I could have the best nutrition because that's why I grow my food. But also more importantly, you know, when the soil wins, the plant wins, and we win. This is, you know, an integrated system, and unfortunately through topsoil degradation and conventional farming, you know, they are destroying the soil, which in my personal opinion is destroying the planet. So I don't want you guys as home gardeners, even if you're large scale farmers, hey, take a stand and start implementing some of the practices I do and take these five elements into consideration so that you guys can have the best garden or farm ever and help the planet as well as the people on the planet out. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, please be sure to share this video with fellow gardeners or other farmers so that they can improve the soil and the health of their plants and the people and the animals that feed on their plants as well, and maybe get less pest damage as well, because that's always my first thing, is to make sure I have the healthiest plants so that I don't have to spray any pesticides in the first place. Because once again, if you spray pesticides, then that's you're taking away the need for the plant to make its own pesticides. Yes, even if it's neem or Dr. Bronner's, as non-toxic as that is, I don't even like to spray that stuff. You know, what I have been spraying lately is the Dr. Zahn's, which I do an episode on, you know, because that's a, you know, that's just a one time and evaporates basically, so it's not systemic and it's going to go away relatively quickly and you can get a good kill. I got a good kill on my aphids that are on some of my starters that I've been a little bit, delayed in planting out. So, also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come out every 5 to 7 days. You remember where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell or the notification bell so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys how to grow your own food in accordance with nature to have the highest quality food and plants that are more bug and disease and pest resistant on the planet. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.